The question is directed to the House managers. In Federalist 65, Alexander Hamilton writes that the subjects of impeachment are, quote, those offenses which proceed from the misconduct of public men or, in other words, from the abuse or violation of some public trust, end quote. Could you speak broadly to the duties of being a public servant and how you believe the President's actions have violated this trust?
Mr. Chief Justice, members of the Senate, President Trump used the powers of his office to solicit a foreign nation to interfere in our elections for his own benefit. Then he actively obstructed Congress in his attempts to investigate his abuses of power. These actions are clearly impeachable. The key purpose of the impeachment clause is to control abuses of power by public officials, that is to say, conduct that violates the public trust. Since the founding of the Republic, all impeachments have been based on accusations of conduct that violates the public trust. When the framers wrote the phrase high crimes and misdemeanors, they intended to capture the conduct of public officials like President Trump, who showed no respect for their oath of office. President Trump ignored the law and the Constitution in order to gain a political favor. The Constitution and his oath of office prohibited him from using his official favor to corruptly benefit himself rather than the American people. That's exactly what the President did, illegally withholding military aid and a White House meeting until the President of Ukraine committed to announcing an investigation of President Trump's opponent. In the words of one constitutional scholar, if what we're talking about is not impeachable, then nothing is impeachable. This is precisely the misconduct that the framers created the Constitution, including impeachment, to protect against. And now I want to add, in reference to some of the comments that were made by some of the President's counsel a few minutes ago. They talk about the subpoena power, about the failure of the House to act properly in the subpoena power, because they said the House did not delegate by rule, have a resolution authorizing the committees to offer subpoena power. They apparently haven't read the fact that the House has generally delegated all subpoena power to the committees. That wasn't true at the time of the Watkins case. It wasn't true 15 years ago, but it is true now. Second, the House has the sole power of impeachment, and the manner of its exercise may not be challenged from outside, whether we do it, whether the President should be convicted upon our accusation is a question for the Senate. But how we reached our accusation is a matter solely for the House. Thirdly, they talk about executive privilege. And they point to the Nixon case that established executive privilege, that the President has a right to private, to candid advice, and therefore executive privilege is established. But the same case says that executive privilege cannot be used to hide wrongdoing. And in fact, President Nixon was ordered in that case to turn over all the material. Thirdly, there's the doctrine of waiver. You cannot use executive privilege or any other privilege if you waive it. The moment President Trump said that John Bolton was not telling the truth when he said that the President told him of the improper quid pro quo, he waived any executive privilege that might have existed. He cannot characterize a conversation and put it into the public domain and then claim executive privilege against it. The President, by the way, never claimed executive privilege, ever. He has claimed instead absolute immunity, a ridiculous doctrine that the President has absolute immunity from any questioning by the Congress or by anybody else, a claim rejected by every court that has ever considered it. And finally, the difference from this President and any other President claiming privilege of any sort is that this President told us in advance, I will defy all subpoenas. Whatever their nature, I will make sure that the Congress gets no information. In other words, I am absolute. The Congress cannot question what I do because I will defy all subpoenas. I will make sure they get no information, no matter what their rights, no matter what the situation. That is the subject of Article 2 of the impeachment, because that is a claim of absolute monarchical power.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. The Majority Leader is recognized.
I'm going to suggest, after two more questions on each side, one more. I've been corrected, as I frequently am. One more question on each side. We take a 15-minute break.
Thank you.
Mr. President.
Yes, the senator from Kansas.
I sent a question to the desk for the counsel for the president.
Thank you. Senator Roberts asks, would you please respond to the arguments or assertions the House managers made in response to the previous questions? Directed to the counsel for the president.
Mr. Chief Justice, members of the Senate, I want to respond to a couple. First, with regard to the question or the issues that have been raised as it relates to witnesses. It's important to note that in the Clinton impeachment proceeding, the witnesses that actually gave deposition testimony were witnesses that had either been interviewed by deposition in the House proceedings, grand jury proceedings, and it was Sid Blumenthal, Verdon Jornan, and Monica Lewinsky. The new witnesses were not being called. That's because the House, in their process, move forward with a full investigation. That did not happen here. There was another statement that was raised by Mr. Chairman Schiff, Manager Schiff, regarding the Chief Justice could make the determination on executive privilege. And again, with no disrespect to the Chief Justice, the idea that the presiding officer of this proceeding could determine a waiver or the applicability of executive privilege would be quite a step. There's nothing historic precedent. There's no historic precedent that would justify it. But there's something else. If we get to the point of witnesses, then, for instance, if one of the witnesses to be called were by the president's lawyers, was Adam Schiff, in the role basically of Ken Starr. Ken Starr presented the report, made the presentation before the House of Representatives, had about 12 hours of questioning, I believe, is what Judge Starr had. If Representative Schiff was called as a witness, would in fact then issues of speech and debate clause privilege be litigated and decided by the presiding officer, or would it go to court, or maybe they would waive it? But those would be the kind of issues that would be very, very significant. Senator Graham presented a hypothetical, which Manager Schiff said, well, that's not really the hypothetical, but hypotheticals actually are that. They're hypotheticals. But I'll give you, to use Manager Schiff's words, he talked about it would be wrong if the FBI or the Department of Justice was starting a political investigation of someone's political opponent. And I'm thinking to myself, but isn't that exactly what happened? The Department of Justice and the FBI engaged in an investigation of the candidate for President of the United States when they started their operation called Crossfire Hurricane. He said it would be targeting a rival. Well, that's what that did. He said it would be calling for foreign assistance in that. Well, in the particular facts of Crossfire Hurricane, it has been well established now that, in fact, Fusion GPS utilized the services of a former foreign intelligence officer, Christopher Steele, to put together a dossier, and that Christopher Steele relied on his network of resources around the globe, including in Russia and other places, to put together this dossier, which then James Comey said was unverified and salacious, but yet it was the basis upon which the Department of Justice and the FBI obtained FISA warrants, and this was in 2016, against a rival campaign. So we don't have to do hypotheticals. That's precisely the situation. But to take it an additional step, this idea that a witness will be called if this body decides to go to witnesses, that a witness will be called would be a violation of fundamental fairness. Of course, if witnesses are called by the House managers through that motion, well, the President's counsel would have the opportunity to call witnesses as well, which we would. Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice.
Thank you, counsel.